Come on, game. Rapidly pushing buttons. You just never know. Get that shield out of my face. Oh crap. No. Don't you dare. I bloody swear. Cool. Go away and you see what happens. Go away. What, you give up? You're destroying entire worlds, of course.
You can change anything.
Explode, please. Oh. Can you be healed? Please tell me you can be healed. Did you just... Aww. Whoa, what's going on? You're kidding.
Bayonetta?
Don't you dare. How is she not being dragged to Inferno right now? That happened with Jean immediately. Oh, of course, as soon as I say it.
She's okay. It seems like we always find each other whenever she needs us.
And we've already come so far.
Fate brought us here together. And it will never tear us apart. We'll always be together, Cereza.
No, Luca. We've always been together.
Not for much longer, though.
Lovely. Will forever be in my heart.
Huh? How did that just... Is he imagining it? Oh, are you kidding? Game dev, if you end that there, I am totally killing you. I like the song, but I'm displeased. game dev. As well, but not for good reasons. I'm hoping there's something good at the end of these credits. If there isn't, then this game dev better hope we never meet, and better hope he's not a dude. That was from Bayonetta 1 right there. Yeah.
just the darkness Arkeev left behind. Allowed to call me that.
Hang on.
Rewind. My name is Viola, and you're never gonna fucking forget it.
I got nothing to say right now.
Yeah.
I thought those things looked similar to his getup.
It was your last lesson, Viola. But for someone who's grown so much, perhaps the gift of a new name is in order.
Thanks, Mummy. I'll treasure it. Always.
Did you see Loki? I know most people would talk about the game and what they thought of it right now, but I got nothing to say. I'm still waiting for something at the end of this. It's been a while. The flowers are in bloom. Well, I should say the trees. Massive allergy for my whole family right there.
Ow! What the hell? Jesus, that hurt! Watch where you're going, asshole! Oh, it's you. Get that prescription check, will ya? Hey, hold on. Remember that last job? The one you half-assed? The adder almost. Took my head off of that shit. I keep telling you, kid. Huh? No. Nobody, you know. Yeah, I know. The baguettes, right? Forget about it. I'm coming straight home. Honest. Direct with the good stuff, right?
Playing hooky again, huh?
That's Locust Scarf from game one.
You know, I'm the one who has to hear it from your pops when you decide to turn my place into study hall.
School's closed today. It is, seriously. So anyway, got anything good for me? Something where I can let off some steam?
Got a leaky roof? Truck salvage? Lost cat and some ghosts haunting an old house.
That's the one. Don't wait up, okay? Cheshire. What?
Viola, that's coming out of your cut for this one. So's his kibble. Shit, my bad. Forgot to use the family name. Be back by curfew. Bayonetta.
Okay. Let's dance, baby!
Oh, she didn't get a dance in game two, so I guess she gets one in three. Technically, she's getting two. Well, three. Considering the pole dance. She had that first one in the one credits. Remix of Let's Dance, boys, I guess. Hey, John.
I think you've had enough for now.
Are you serious?
Bayonetta.
So let me get this straight. Everyone pretty much died except for Viola. Although from what looked like in that last scene, Rodan mentioned her papa. We all know that's Luca. But was there some universe where she didn't lose her parents, so she went there somehow? I'm thinking perhaps no, though, because it said to be continued in New Generation. So my first guess is, if they do another Bayonetta, it's gonna be Viola. You don't kill the main character. You just don't do that. I'll never play Outlast. Not just because it's a horror game I wouldn't like to play because it's first person and you can't fight back, but because the main character dies at the end of it. After all the crap he goes through, he effing dies. I do not like things with a bad or sad ending. And it looks to me Bayonetta 3 has an absolutely trash ending. There's a lot of aspects to this I didn't like. I hated every level with Jean because I don't like games like that. I don't even watch them much. They're not my thing. I didn't like any occasion where I had to control Gamora because of how slow he is. And how hard to make him move it is. Yes, him too! And then Assassin's Creed did it again with another main character. They killed her too in Valhalla. I haven't watched Assassin's Creed since then. Heck, I haven't watched gameplay for that seriously since Assassin's Creed Syndicate. I didn't ever even watch a full playthrough of Assassin's Creed Valhalla. Just a streamer I was watching was supporting a friend, and I caught the tail end of Valhalla, and I about raged. So Assassin's Creed series did it twice. They killed off a main character two times. Once was bad enough, but twice? Effin' dude, why? Another thing I didn't like about this game was playing as Viola. I realized they were trying to go for something new, but from game 1 and 2, the way you witch time is with a dodge. Viola, you had to block. Hated that. Then there was so many occasions where they threw you into something, and you didn't really get a chance to adjust to it. You just had to go, 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 go. The number of times I got effed over because of that is quite a lot, and I did not appreciate it. The switching characters through levels things, different levels, made me think of Devil May Cry 5. The only time I ever heard anyone complain about that was that certain people didn't like V. And considering how Devil May Cry is always played, I understood that. I've never played it personally, I don't even have it. Yeah, she's not that cool. I don't mind her playstyle for the most part. It's just, the way you witch time irritates the crap out of me. It's too different and that's not how it's ever worked before. Not to mention, I really hate her character design. I don't mind her clothes, but the makeup irritates me. Heck, the makeup on all the female characters has looked effing off. I didn't like Cereza's hairstyle that much. It was basically a callback to when she was a kid, and okay, but I don't think it looked too good on her older model. Then that stupid bow on the back of her outfit. Other than that, and her makeup, I didn't mind her design. Hated Jean's design, though. Absolutely hated it. My first thought when I saw her was drag queen attempt. Hated Jean's levels with a passion. I didn't even try to do good in them, I just wanted to get through them, because I don't like crap like that. I hate it. Most of the character designs in this, I haven't liked. Rodan was kind of plain. I have no complaints on him, and Enzo, again, no complaints really. Some of the counterparts to Jean and Cereza in the other worlds, little iffy, but for the most part, I liked them. The only one I can seriously say I didn't like for Cereza was that last one in Paris. Really didn't like that appearance. And you were constantly getting a new enemy type. It felt like every level, you were getting a new type of enemy. Not to mention, I hated how they wouldn't stagger or stun for the most part. Even enemies in 1 and 2 would do that if you hit them hard enough or long enough. The only time they kinda did that was when you summoned an Infernal. But even then, they wouldn't stagger for long, or at all. Didn't like that too much. The enemies, period. I don't have a ton of hate to throw their way, except for ever since the first time I saw them, they felt wrong. It could just be because we're used to dealing with angels, and then in game 2 we got used to the demons. They all made sense. But the singularity stuff hasn't really, and I don't even get what his deal was. The name Singularity says a lot. Maybe he just wants to be all that exists. I don't know. I never got a clear answer on that, and I'm probably gonna have to look some stuff up when I'm done with stream. And I already said I'm not gonna platinum this game. There's too many levels I wouldn't want to replay. Jean's are obvious. I'm definitely not replaying those. I like Viola's combat style fine enough, just I don't like her witch time. And there's plenty of levels with Cereza that I struggled with. It's just, I'm not platinuming this. The only level I've got a platinum on, I think, was the second, no, technically the first level, because the prologue doesn't really count. I was trying to pure plat it earlier as practice, and then it's just trying to pure platinum it, but I kept getting too irritated whenever I'd get hit every so often when I fail a dodge, or I didn't see something taking a swing. Platinuming stuff isn't easy for me. I did it in 1 and 2, and I got a couple pure plats. But in this, I think stuff moves too fast, or it hits too hard. And it's just too different. It would take a lot for me to get used to it fully. And I can tell you right now, I don't have the patience. And I can't believe I'm gonna say this. I didn't really like the game. I was really hyped to play this. Fire even tried to get it for me, but because GameStop wasn't an affiliated site with Throne, it didn't work. Instead, the money just went into my Throne wallet. But then my brother was nice enough to get it for me, and I'm feeling kind of like he wasted his money now. I don't hate it entirely, the game. There's a lot of moments it was really fun to push the buttons, just like in 1 and 2. I think it's just that it's too different. And then the main thing is that the ending is absolute trash. You can't kill the main character! Or characters, plural! You don't do that! If you wanted to introduce a new character to play as, then have it so Cereza and Jean have to do something else someplace else, and have Viola do the main thing. Don't just effing kill off the character! If they make a Bayonetta 4 and it's just Viola, I'm not touching it. I don't effing care, I'm not touching it. Maybe I'll look it up on YouTube, but I will not touch it. I'm mad. And upset. I'm not really the type for that, honestly. I'll keep the game. Maybe I'll play it every now and again still. But heck, another thing, I hated the music for the most part. There was only a couple of songs in this whole game I liked. Cereza's main battle theme, I absolutely hated it when I first heard it, and every time it popped up again, I still hated it. I couldn't warm up to it. It was too cutesy. I liked Viola's theme. Jean's theme wasn't any different. A couple of boss fights were pretty cool on the music. The ending credits song, that one song where that Cereza was dancing to, I liked that. but for the most part, I effing didn't like the music. We'll see. If I have to give it a rating from 1 out of 100, I would say 30 or 40. Because there was just too much about this I didn't like and outright hated in some spots. And this will really say something. I would rather play Tales of Symphonia Dawn of the New World way more often than I'll touch this. And considering I've only beaten that once, and my current run of this on Twitch is only my second playthrough, that tells you something. How much more I like Dawn of the New World than this right now. And the main kicker was the fact that they killed Cereza. They killed Jean. They killed Luca. They killed all the main people off, basically. Yeah, I can just plainly say I didn't like this that much. At some points I hated playing it. Now, I was really worried about that ending because when I was looking it up on YouTube for guides to get better scores, I kept finding occasional video titles that said the ending messed them up or made them cry. So I was worried. Apparently I had nothing right to be. If when we saw Viola at the end in Rodan's bar, he mentioned her papa. We know that's Luca. And we saw him allow himself to get dragged into Inferno with Cereza. And if, since Rodan was mentioning him, maybe she ended up in a world where her parents were okay. But I don't know. I'm going to be looking stuff up after this because I want absolute certainty that the game devs actually dared to kill off all the important characters. Honestly, right now I feel like smashing my keyboard. The only reason I'm not is because I can't afford to get another one. Like, and how many times while I was playing this did I say I would rather do something else that I hate more? Like, I kept saying I'd rather fight Martyr Logarius in Bloodborne, and I hate that boss fight so much because he's so challenging. I'm just not good at the game, really, but that tells you how much I was getting fed up. I was also saying I'd rather fight Father Baldur or Jean. And I hate fighting both of them. That just goes to show how much I was getting mad. Hi, Templar. Hope you're having a better effing day than me. I was gonna try to play something else after this. I was thinking maybe Skyrim. But I am so not in the effing mood now. I am angry and upset. I cannot believe they effing did this. Now, I'm gonna leave stream going and go on the laptop and look some stuff up just so I can get clarification right now. Well, from what I'm able to tell, I'm not the only one who absolutely hated this ending, or the prospect of potentially Viola being the one as Bayonetta from now on. But yes, they did kill off all the main characters. And apparently in discussions for potential Game 4, no one knows quite what's gonna happen there. Maybe it's a reversal effect of whatever happened, or it's based in the past. No one knows. I can tell you right now, if they make a fourth game, I'm looking it up first. I'm not gonna just play it blind. I won't. Because I don't want to see something like this again. I don't really have anything else to say about this game. For the most part, I didn't like it. And in some parts, I hated it. Very minorly did I enjoy it. I'll probably still play it now and again, but compared to 1 and 2, there's no contest. 1 and 2, 100% better. I think I'm just gonna end stream. I don't really care to do my ending spiel. I'm not in the mood, I don't care. Yeah, I'm just gonna go. I hope the rest of you had more fun watching this than I had fun anything playing it. See you in the next stream, whenever the F that's gonna be. Whatever it is going to be. I don't even know what I'm playing next, because right now I just don't care about crap all. Wish you all well. Bye. Hello, Twilight. MidnaLikesWaffles here. Hope you can hear me okay and you see me okay. This isn't a news video, as you can tell by the title. I'll be up front now and say I'm not really a game reviewer. I don't think I know games well enough to do something like that, but in Bayonetta 3's case, I feel like I'm going to attempt it. Now, it's been 2 days since I beat 3. I feel better than I did when I beat it. I was literally unwilling to do anything else that night. I was so angry and upset by that ending. And I wasn't the only one who couldn't handle the ending. Although, for different reasons. I was looking up reviews on YouTube, honestly. I wanted to see if other people agreed with the reasons I disliked the game. And it appears to go back and forth. Like, different people have different opinions on the game, which makes sense because, like Dandelion / Yoxter says in the Witcher series on Netflix, opinions are like a-holes, which everybody's got. Oh, that song was funny. Anyway, yeah, so things kind of go different directions with Bayonetta 3, with a wide variety of people, but a common theme was most reviewers didn't like the game storyline. Apparently, one in particular viewer always felt there was no real sense in any of the storylines. I have to call that person out and say, I don't even remember their usernames. I can't even call them out properly. Well, not really call them out, it's more like a correction of pay attention. Or look it up online. I mean, you get a lot of information from the game 1 and 2 if you read the little booklets that you pick up during the game. You get information about the angels when you get a new enemy angel. There's also books for the Infernals. More advanced in 2, since you're actually in Inferno. And you also have journal notebooks that you pick up from Luca's father in Game 1, and then Luca's own notes from Game 2. This has a lot of interesting information in it, and it helps you understand what's going on. If you have missed out on something and you don't get the F what's happening, I just recommend looking it up, trying to do a little bit of research. I did that occasionally until I realized, wait, the game has books in it. Why am I not reading these? If the game isn't giving you all the information you need, like a Souls game doesn't do, but they do that deliberately, honestly. For kind of a cool reason, if I'm honest. But then that's just when you have to start looking up lore online, trying to figure out what the heck happened and what did you miss. And it's like, after you know the lore and you play the game again, at least for me, things make more sense, and you can notice where it's pointing out these things for the story. I noticed it, but I don't know. It could just be me, I understood the story pretty okay, but I don't know. And I'm talking about 1 and 2, because there was one viewer who was just saying the storyline has always been confusing and not understandable. I didn't agree with that, but hey, that's just me. Heck, the other viewers I watched who mentioned the story didn't even say they never understood it. It was just the one person who said it. So I'm not sure what that person's deal was. Maybe they need something more straightforward? I don't know. Either way, a common thing with the reviewers I watched, I think I watched like 5 different people, more or less. 2 of them I particularly liked, because one guy, his video was like 30 minutes. He had good things to say about the game and bad things to say about it. I liked that it was balanced out and he wasn't just trashing it the whole time, because I don't really want to do that, but I'm not sure if I can. Another reviewer, honestly, I saved his video because I laughed so hard at the end of his review. He gave the game a 5 out of 10. Primarily because they gave Viola the name Bayonetta at the end, and he absolutely hated her. I didn't think she was terrible, but there were a lot of things about her I didn't like. Such as the game doesn't take her seriously despite the fact that she is a pretty serious story character. Not in personality, but she's important to the storyline and should be taken seriously, but she wasn't. I think they were trying to give you more hints as to who her parents are. Because we've seen Luca do stupid crap a lot, but the guy still has some style, so they didn't really do that correctly. I wouldn't say I hated her like this guy did, though. Seriously, as soon as Rodan called Viola Bayonetta, the guy instantly turned his game off, started swearing, and called out the developers of Platinum. Let's just say he did not react well to that. I cracked up so hard because I couldn't believe how much he hated that character. I didn't think she was entirely bad, but I did agree with all of his points. Anyway, those are just the reviews I was looking at and what was most memorable to me. I'll even leave some links in this video description, because this is actually going to come after my actual reaction to the ending of the game. I only got the real primary ending part where, okay, if you haven't played the game or seen it, obviously this is going to be spoilery, so dude, leave now. I only really got the part where Bayonetta / Cereza and Luca died at the end. And I don't even think Luca had to die, honestly. He chose to go with her to Inferno, which I can understand. And did they ever fully explain why he turned into that thing? I'm not sure they did. I think that's something I'm gonna have to read in the books and the game, or look it up online, because like, he turns into a wolf, werewolf-like monster because of the quotation marks truth? Huh? Question marks all over the screen. It's like, what? I wouldn't say the storyline in the game is bad, like most of the reviewers I saw were saying, particularly that one person, but I felt I had to agree with a couple of them that the story didn't feel that good. When you first start, it's kind of okay. But I was constantly waiting for them to explain Singularity properly. I don't know if he has anything in the enemy books or scrolls, really. I'll have to look at that, but I did look stuff up online because I wanted confirmation as to the ending of if what we saw happened is exactly what happened. That was, much to my extreme fury and despair. And it just seems like, putting it plainly, he was a man-made bioweapon that gained sentiency and turned against his human creators, killed them all, destroyed, I think, his own world, or at least just slaughtered everyone else who existed, except for himself, of course. Then decided he's going to destroy all of the other trinities of reality, simply because he wants to. Or he's just after more power to make himself stronger. I don't know a lot about Devil May Cry. Definitely don't know crap all about Virgil for the most part, but people kept referencing him whenever they mentioned that. So is he just a power seeker and that's all he cares about? I'm gonna guess that's it. I know he did kind of a change in 5, considering what he did to himself. If you haven't played that or seen it, I'm not gonna say what happened. Heck, I haven't even played it myself, I've just seen it. And I might have misunderstood what I watched, so I'm definitely not going to say anything. I don't have the right to say anything on that regard. But they didn't really explain Singularity. His name made it pretty clear what his gimmick was. He wants to be all that there is, and that seems like a lonely existence, but I don't think he really cared. And one reviewer I watched, I don't remember if it's one of the two guys I saved. I know it wasn't the one dude who raged at the ending. I'm not sure if it was the other dude either, but I can watch the video again. But the reviewer was calling Singularity some pathetic nobody. And he even called out the fact that Inferno and Paradiso are not reacting to the situation at all. Which made sense, because even I found that a little weird, but I was too busy trying to figure out how the game was going to end to think about it fully. It did occur to me a few times, but that was it. Like, the whole Trinity of Realities is in danger, and the only one who seems to be doing about it is Jean, Bayonetta, and Viola. Well, Luca. But he wasn't really able to do much until, like, the tail end. All the time the Infernals got involved was when they were summoned through the Infernal Contracts. Well, I shouldn't word it like that, but they got summoned by the witches, really. But you would think they would have been more involved, Paradiso and Inferno, considering their very existence is being threatened. It's not just Earth. Paradiso and Inferno as a whole were going to be destroyed. And nothing. Like, they didn't care or something. It's like, whatever. That, I have to agree, that one doesn't really make any sense, like, at all. And the only time you even see Infernals or Angels, like you did in games 1 and 2, is with little angel portals or side mission things. It's, why? If they weren't going to play a role, then don't have them in the game. I'm just going to put that out right now. It was cool to see them. Heck, I know I was happy to see them most of the time because I didn't like the homunculi too much. They were strange. I didn't like them from the get-go, if I'm honest. They're too different from the Infernals and the Angels. It was too weird. They were too different. That's best I can put it. Not to mention, you really couldn't stagger the fools. I didn't like that. The only way you could really do it was with summoning an Infernal yourself and hitting them a bunch. And even then, they still might not stagger. Really didn't like that. The only time an enemy didn't stagger in 1 and 2 is if they were a boss. Because you could stagger those really big guys. It just took a lot of hitting him, but you could do it. Don't get me wrong, Bayonetta slash Cereza can stagger a homunculi, but usually it has to be with the Infernal, and my opinion, I didn't mind the Demon Slave mechanic, but the whole time I played the game, I was missing what they did in 2, because that was pretty sweet. And the main reviewer I saved his link on, he didn't like that change either. Because I remember I was messing with some of the combos during training and during fights when I first started playing. And it's like, why does this feel weird? I couldn't figure it out, but when I watched the reviewer, he pointed out what the problem was. As soon as he said it, I knew. I knew why it felt weird. Through game 1 and 2, it's a little less long-lasting in 2, but it's still highly effective. You can keep holding the kick or punch button to keep shooting bullets. You don't do that in 3. Don't get me wrong, you can still do it, but the second you start to wicked weave, you don't shoot anymore. You just summon the infernal demon limb and smack something. That's not how it worked in 1 and 2. And that was what bothered me, that they took that away. They also took away the ability to have weapons on your feet, and that did bug me a little bit, but I liked the weapons well enough I wasn't going to complain about it. Oh boy, did that one reviewer complain about it. He didn't like that at all. Which I understand, because that's been a thing since game 1. They just improved upon it in game 2, and then in game 3 they took it away to replace it with the Demon Slave thing and the Demon Masquerade. I personally didn't really like the Demon Masquerade. I barely used it, frankly, because I didn't like most of it half the time. And heck, the only one I liked it on was Bayonetta's first Infernal Demon, the butterfly, weird-looking moth thing, and then Viola's. I liked hers. I didn't mess with a lot of Bayonetta slash Cereza's Demon Masquerade moves, where you push the two sticks down and you change for a minute. I didn't really mess with her other ones, because I wasn't impressed with anything beyond her main Infernal. I just wasn't. If we take this piece at a time, I can say I didn't entirely dislike and hate the game, but for the most part I did. The biggest deal breaker was how they ended it. In my opinion, you don't kill the main character. You just don't do that. When any game, movie, or TV show does this, I instantly don't like it much anymore. I mean, I'll never play Outlast, not just because it's a first-person horror game where you can't fight back. It's because of how it ends. If you haven't seen it, then, or played it, then I recommend you go do that. And if you're still here after spoilers I've been talking about, then what are you doing here? Miles Upshur dies at the end of Outlast. After everything he goes through, the man dies. Hated that. Another game example I have is Assassin's Creed, a game series I have liked for a long time, and I haven't looked into since Syndicate? I think Syndicate, yeah. There were a lot of games before they made me angry. There was the Assassin's Creed 1, which was, I think, them just figuring out if it was going to work or not, because there wasn't much to it. I did play that one. I think I beat it, but I can't remember. I might have, I don't know. However, I know once I was finished with it, whether or not I beat it, I don't know. I took it back to GameStop because it was all I could really do was the main story, and the little side things were kind of meh. I liked 2 better, but the main kicker for me... Sorry, I had to cough. The main kicker for me in Assassin's Creed is that your combat is slow. I do not like slow combat. I tried 4, same problem, combat was slow. But if I was just watching the games, I got through Assassin's Creed 1, I got through Ezio's whole thing, and then we come to 3. 3, where they, spoiler, effing kill off Desmond. The main character, they kill him. I instantly hated that, but I was willing to give the game a chance still. I kept watching them. But whenever you weren't in the Animus, I couldn't get myself to like the game. I just liked watching the assassin part in the past. I managed to kind of get through Unity. I liked the concept of what was going on in the Animus bit, but I don't even remember what was going on in reality in that one. In Syndicate, I just gave up on what was happening in reality, and I barely even watched Syndicate all the way through because I was getting sick of the BS and not understanding what the F was going on in reality, because that is part of the game. But it's like, what's going on? I didn't really watch Assassin's Creed again after Syndicate. I know there was the one based in Egypt with the new character. I don't think they had a proper new character in 4 or any of the other games until you got to the Egyptian one, yeah? Yeah, I think so. I feel like I'm forgetting a game though. I mean, it went from Egypt to Valhalla, yes? I don't remember, but I do know that they kill off that new main character in Valhalla as well. So they killed their main character effing twice. Why? Once was bad enough, but you did it effing twice. For me, it was like Assassin's Creed went on too long. They should have called it somewhere. If they were going to keep doing stuff, maybe they should have given it a different title or something. I don't know. But I feel that way about a lot of things. If it continues on too long, I start to lose interest in it because it changes and becomes something else and I don't like it. I could be the only one who feels this way, and if so, okay. That's fine. It's just me. Everyone else can keep enjoying it. They don't have to cater to my likes. Heck, they shouldn't. The heck, I'm actually hungry this morning. Well, whenever, it can wait. But killing off your main character is something I'll never approve of. It doesn't matter what it is or what your reason is. I just don't like that. And when they did it in Bayonetta 3, oh my gosh. You've seen my reaction already. It's before this whole conversation occurs. I took it badly. Like, in all the reviews I watched, no one really commented on the fact that they killed Bayonetta, Jean, and Luca. Other than the one guy who said Jean is still useless, and frankly, I couldn't disagree. We don't really see much of her. We know that she's very good friends with Cereza Bayonetta. But in game 2, she gets whacked by Gamora instantly, and Bayonetta Cereza has to go to Infernal to get her back. Now, we watched this happen to Bayonetta Cereza too, instantly just done as soon as she gets hit by this guy, which makes me wonder why she summoned him. Maybe she should have summoned a different one. Like, maybe Madame Butterfly wouldn't have whacked her. but like, you don't really interact with her much in game one, and for the whole time she's mind controlled and you have amnesia, so you can't really interact well. She's mostly just there to train you, remind you of what you can do. Two, well, you really don't see her much because she's Inferno after all. Three, I hated everything about Jean in three, and I'm not the only one. It seemed like no one really liked her weird stealth mission chapters. Some people kind of liked the bosses, but they didn't like how the chapter itself worked too much. I know I loathed every second of it. That type of game is not my thing. I felt like it was a Metal Gear reference, honestly, which that's fine. But I've kind of seen tidbits of the first couple games and they weren't side-scrollers. At least not that I remember. I don't know why they decided to do that, not to mention the very limited HP she has and that she can't really double jump. She can't really fight. You're supposed to stealth kill. Dude, what? Why? Why was this a cool idea? And then her overall appearance. Let me rant about character appearance later. I hated almost all the designs of the characters. I'm not the only one who didn't really like a lot of character designs either. But Jean, basically effing useless, and throughout the whole game when you're in different universes, you always see Jean get whacked before Bayonetta / Cereza. So, with the number of times we saw that happen, I was not surprised when she got killed by Singularity. I didn't really react to it because I knew it was coming. And I couldn't find myself to be overly sad about it because it's like, it kind of makes me think of Thief, where the whole game, Garrett is like thinking about Aaron. We see her once in the prologue. Then we get little flashbacks and crap of her. The only one we interact with is Basso, and when he ends up getting arrested and dragged off to prison, all the players freak out because it's like, no, that's my friend, you can't have him! But Garrett is constantly on about Aaron, who we don't see for long. We have no reason to like this girl. In fact, I don't even like her that much because I don't think she really listened to what Garrett was trying to teach her. Not to mention, a proper thief doesn't kill people. I think of a proper thief like Garrett. He goes in, he gets out. Well, he goes in, takes what he's after, then he gets the F out. If he absolutely has to subdue someone, he will, but it's not permanent damage. He doesn't like to hurt people or kill them, necessarily. He absolutely hates killing. But that's a proper thief. If you kill someone and then loot, that makes you a bandit. If you loot then kill, same thing. I'm sorry, but you're a bandit, not a thief. At least that's just the way I look at it. But anyway, that's how I view Jean like Aaron. You don't see her enough in the games to really get attached. The only one I remotely kind of cared about the whole time was Luca, and that's because you actually see him a lot. I cared about Viola because how obvious they made her parentage. There were so many hints. At the very tail end, she nearly calls Bayonetta mummy. So, again, that's basically confirmation. And I knew almost immediately from how she reacted to Bayonetta 1 dying to Singularity. And then she had magic. I constantly wondered, was she just a good friend that Bayonetta had made? So she and Jean decided to teach her the Umbran arts? I wasn't sure about that theory. So then I was like, well, what if my original theory is correct and she's Bayonetta's daughter from another universe and Luca's her dad? I wasn't wrong. They didn't make it really that hard to figure out, if I'm honest. So should we break this down? you start the game watching Bayonetta trying and failing at killing some mysterious entity. I didn't mind this because it didn't look like the current Bayonetta. I was figuring, is this some alternate universe or something? Or was this her past and she somehow managed to come back from it? So yeah, it bothered me to watch her get destroyed. It was kind of like how Psychedelic Snake reacted to Devil May Cry the first time when you watch Dante lose. That just doesn't happen. So when it switches to the world we're usually in, main Bayonetta's world, I immediately had some peeves with the game for character design. I love Bayonetta Thastorese's look half the time. I didn't like the beehive hairstyle from 1, but it kind of grew on me a bit. I didn't like her really short hair in game 2, and it takes a long time for me to like it, and even when I do kind of like it, I mostly still don't like it. In 3, why did they even do that? She has her hairstyle from when she was a kid, and I don't think it looks too good. Not to mention, the makeup on all the female characters looks off. At a distance, it's not bad, sometimes, but if you get a close-up of their face, oh, I don't think the makeup looks good at all. Now, I'm a novice at using makeup myself. I haven't started messing with it until I hit drinking age, and that was a couple years ago now or so. I don't remember exactly. But I haven't really used a lot of makeup, and I don't put it on often either because I find it a hassle to have to take off, not to mention... whatever, it doesn't matter. Either way, I thought the makeup looked weird on Bayonetta / Cereza, and I didn't like it. There was also her hair. I really didn't like the hairstyle. On her kid model, it looked fine. In fact, it was pretty cute. On adult, I couldn't get myself to like it. I hated it every time I saw it. I tried to ignore it and focused on her Umbran outfit, and even that I didn't fully like. I liked everything about her outfit except for when you see her turned around. There's a giant effing bow on the back. It's basically like she's got another pair of pigtails. The bow alone I don't like, but the fact that it's... Well, Umbran armor is basically their hair, but you know what? You get my point, right? I didn't like the bow or the hairstyle, period. It looked silly. And Bayonetta Sasereza isn't silly, dude. She's sexy, she's beautiful, she's confident, and she ain't got no problem telling you where to stuff it. She'll dance circles around you either verbally or physically, literally. She'll tease you, then shove you away. It's like, we have this cutesy, stupid, giant bow? No. Hers was the only character design I only had minor problems with. Well, it was not a character, but I didn't fully like that one either. Rodan, I didn't really have much to say about because he looked so plain. I just kind of head-tilted at him and was like, well, okay. He just looked too plain. So I couldn't really dislike or like it. It was kind of a head-tilt moment. Enzo, he was fine for the most part. I didn't really care about him, though. As for Jean, oh my gosh, Jean. First time she appeared on screen, I was immediately like, do not let this be who I think it is. And I legit said something like that. And when Bayonetta Sasereza said her name, I immediately was like, no! The first thought I had when I saw Jean was drag queen. And some of those aren't terrible. Not that I've seen many, mind you, but I know some can make it look good. Jean just made me think of a drag queen attempt. And I hated it. She didn't look good at all. I didn't mind her in game 2. Game 1, I was iffy because of how short her hair was. And her makeup was really weird around the eyes. Game 2, I think she was okay. In fact, she was sort of pretty. Game 3, I have nothing good to say about her. I'm sorry, I just don't. Even playing her chapters, which I hated, I have literally nothing good to say about Jean in this one. The only character I can safely say I liked their design 100% was Luca. He looked really interesting and cool. He still wasn't suave as he wanted to be, but that's Luca. Viola... strongly disliked her makeup, but I didn't mind the punk rock type of style she was going for. It was mostly the makeup I couldn't stand. And while I didn't mind her combat style, I hated how throughout all the game series until now, your witch time is a perfectly timed dodge. With her, it's a block. Why did we go there? Why a block? It could just be them wanting to try something different. Okay, sure. But it made playing her not really a lot of fun. You have to constantly tell your brain to remember, don't dodge, block. It sucks. That was my only beef with playing as her. Otherwise, I didn't mind. I really didn't mind at all. She was pretty fun. Even when she summons Cheshire, I don't mind it. It takes a minute to readjust, but that was the only part of her combat I absolutely hated. When it comes to the combat in the game, period, I don't strongly dislike it. In fact, it's still tons of fun to push the buttons. But I did have to agree with some of the reviewers I watched in that it's like they were nerfing Bayonetta / Cereza. She did some impressive crap in game 1. She would beat the crap out of things, build up her magic meter enough to throw them into some torture device. Although even I had to agree it was kind of stupid, the other angels would just stand around and wait for you to finish. Game 2, you can still do that, only the quick time button mashes a little bit faster, which was nice. And then you had the Umbran Climax, where you could basically go into serious mode whenever you wanted to. At least that's what I'm calling it. And you would summon your infernal demons during your combos at the very tail end. That was cool, and it was fun to do. Heck, you all know I love the Hydra. So cool. But then in game 3, you take away her ability to keep shooting things through a wicked weave. Why? And instead of her doing some of the combat sometimes, you have to summon an infernal. I gotta tell you, after a while, I didn't really like this function myself. I preferred fighting it, the enemies, on my own, because the infernals, they can actually get enraged if a meter goes up too high and they'll attack you. That wasn't fun to deal with. They can also get insta-killed, which also wasn't fun to deal with. I did think the concept was cool, and the little dance she does the whole time is pretty awesome, but you can't do anything while she's doing Demon Slave. The few times where the Infernals would keep attacking and it confused me, it was actually because it remembers the commands you gave the Infernals, and they'll finish the command before disappearing. So, you can put a bunch of things down and then go attack yourself, so you're fighting in sync with the Infernal, but after that runs out, the button commands you did, the Infernal will just disappear, so you can't just keep the Infernal with you the whole time. And you're gonna be surprised, but I don't actually like how the magic meter works. It recharges. It effing recharges. What? It does go up if you witch time an attack. It goes up faster, but dude, through 1 and 2, you have to attack to get this thing. I don't think if you got hit in 2, you would lose it like you did in 1, which I can understand. She had amnesia and didn't have the full source of power, so she was a little finicky on what she was doing. But it seems like in game 3, I have to agree with some reviewers that she just takes a back seat and lets the Infernal do it. Not really a good call. Heck, the one guy compared her to V from Devil May Cry 5. Except V was done right from what he was, how he was explaining it, whereas Bayonetta / Cereza wasn't. Because she can still be attacked, and she really can't move from that spot, whereas V, if you handle his demons well, you can just waltz around the battle arena and not worry about getting hit, because his demon summons are dealing with everything. It looked really cool when he was showing a clip of this. Review's just walking around, playing with his little cane, or reading from his book, or laughing maniacally, and the enemies just can't touch him because they're too busy getting worked over by his summons. That looked really awesome. It made him look so cool. But we come to Bayonetta 3, and all you can do is stand there. The second you dodge or try to move away, you won't move away because you're controlling the Infernal. You'll just keep standing there. If you dodge, it does break the concentration she has going. So it's like, it's cool for a bit, but then it's just like, I wish this worked differently. I hated how you move faster. Why did you have to change that? I swear the Panther Within thing moved faster than most of those other things you could do with Demon Masquerade. I didn't like that from the get-go. I thought it was weird. Some of them look cool, don't get me wrong, but they really weren't that quick. And when you get to the boss fight and you play as Bayonetta 1, when I did Panther Within, I was like, oh, I missed you. That goes to show just how much I was missing that the whole time, and how much I didn't like the new thing they did. I don't think anyone else had big beefs with that, but I know I didn't like it too much. One particular reviewer I watched really didn't like Demon Slave. He thought it was cool, but broken. It just did too much damage too fast. He didn't like it. So he barely used it unless he absolutely had to. I kind of got to that point at the tail end because it was like, it was faster for me to attack on my own, and I could still kill things. It might just take a little longer, which I think was why my time score was always bad. You're supposed to use the Infernals. But there are some enemies in the game when if you do that, they split into more and then you have more crap to kill. Wasn't a fan of that aspect. And And then I really had to agree with the one guy whenever Bayonetta slash Cereza ripped out her heart to summon big, beefy, infernal demon. It was cool. Do not get me wrong or get him wrong. Even he thought it was cool. But she does it too much. And there's no ill effect to her, which I didn't understand myself. And he even pointed it out. It was like, oh, someone agreed with me on that one. The woman rips out her heart and then just puts it back like nothing happened. I mean, the first time it appears to mess with her a little bit. But after that, nah. And then she just keeps doing it. I agree with him and think maybe just doing it for the final boss would have been the better choice. Instead of every big thing. Because, dude, those guys wouldn't have been the first time little tiny ant has gone up against giant person. Look at Bayonetta 1, all the colossal giants that she killed in that. Jubileus even, and that's something else I'm going to rant about soon. Bayonetta 2 wasn't much different in that regard. There were plenty of giant things in there to kill. But we get to 3, and the really gigantor crap in there, she rips her heart out and summons the biggest version of the demon possible she can. Don't get me wrong, I liked it a few times, but most of the time, especially with Gamora, I hated it. If it was a reference to Godzilla, then cool, nice, I'm sure someone appreciated that, but I didn't because of how slow it was. I hated the slowness. And I wasn't the only one who hated it, because there was one reviewer who was like, this slow combat is not Bayonetta. This is all about fast, chaotic, in-your-face combat, and this ain't it. I had to agree with the dude. Or lady. I don't remember who that was. But I didn't like it at all. Heck, I didn't like controlling Gamora for the most part, period, because of how slow he was. I only used him sometimes. I preferred Madama Butterfly because, well, she's the main Infernal and she looks awesome. I didn't mind Malphus. And the Toad is actually kind of cool if you make it sing 4 times. You get an acid rain which just destroys everything. But yeah, The Demon Masquerade, I wasn't a fan of it entirely, barely used it, and you get it kind of at a point where you get Umbreon Climax immediately in Game 1. I don't think you get anything seriously cool in Game 2. In Game 1, I don't think you get anything seriously cool like that. But again, she has amnesia and she's relearning what she can do. Game 2, you get it immediately. Maybe a little too soon, but she has had time to readjust and relearn everything properly, so it makes enough sense. In Game 3, that move would have been nice to have a little sooner. And be a bit more effective than it actually was. Maybe I'd need to play with it some more, but I haven't heard a lot of other people say good things about it either, so I think it's not just me who dislikes it. Demon Slave itself, I don't hate. It's just too strange, and they shouldn't have made the magic meter regen. If they did, it should have been really slow, and majorly encourage you to fight, and they should not have made it so you can't do torture attacks as you please whenever it's full. But they did that to encourage you using Demon Slave, and that is how you even get torture attacks, by using the demons. But there's no button mash, it's just a tiny cutscene. Which really messed me up the first time it happened. It's like, wait, what just happened? I didn't have to push a button. Some people like the fact that the button mashing was gone. I never minded it too much. I just make sure I pushed all the buttons and rolled the stick around, because I never knew what it was going to do. But I think I can agree with people, the reviewers I watched, the Demon Slave thing was too OP, or it's just something you can use way too much. I didn't like the loss of the using torture attacks whenever you wanted, and the magic meter refilling on its own. I don't think that was the best of ideas. You've always had to work for it before. Now you don't. I mean, you can make it go up faster, don't get me wrong, but it still just refills on its own. No. No. Just no. No, 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 no. That, no. Another beef I had with it, and I only found one guy who agreed with me on this. I didn't like most of the songs in the game. The music itself is mostly fine, but the songs, the lyrical stuff... The first one we hear is Bayonetta / Cereza's battle theme. I instantly didn't like it. It was too cutesy for me. At least that's how I describe it, as cutesy. You get Bayonetta 1, you have Mysterious Destiny and Fly Me to the Moon. Both are awesome. In game 2, I love Tomorrow is Mine and Moon River, especially Tomorrow is Mine. I love that sucker. Then you have 3 with... What's that even called? Moonlit Serenade or something? I don't know, but I don't like it. It sounds cutesy. And Bayonetta ain't really cute. She's more in the sexy category. Teasing and taunting you than walking away like she didn't even do anything. That song so just does not work with her. The other battle theme, I don't know what that one's called and I don't hear much of it. I didn't mind it as much. In fact, it had like an Italian-French-like feel that I didn't mind, but I still don't like it too much. In fact, the only battle theme I can say I actually liked was Viola's. Although that one got mixed results too with the reviewers, but I didn't mind her battle theme. When it comes to boss songs, I liked a couple of them, and I did like that one ending credits song, We Are As One, is that what it was called? I think so. However, I couldn't enjoy it too much the first time we heard it because I was so mad and upset about that ending. But I didn't like a lot of the soundtrack in this one, whereas in the first two, there was a lot of songs I enjoyed. I won't say the music is entirely bad, it's just I really didn't enjoy it the way I did with 1 and 2. And in fact, I didn't enjoy playing 3 as much as I did 1 and 2. Heck, I platinumed 1 and 2, and even got a couple pure platinums. One of those was an accident and one which I still can't believe I did, but I got it. I've only managed to platinum, I think, 2 levels in Bayonetta 3. First level is Chapter 1, where I deliberately went out of my way to try to do that. Another one, I think, was actually, shockingly enough, a Jean level, which I can't believe that happened. I'll have to look at the chapters again to see if that's correct. But if I clear platinum any level, it's going to be Chapter 1, and then I'm not going to mess with any of the others, because this game is hard. And I am not good at it. It works too differently. Not to mention, I really just don't have the patience to do it because of how much I don't like the game. Frankly, I have to agree with that one reviewer who reacted to the ending badly that Bayonetta 3 was a bit of a disappointment. I did learn that there were staff changes because a dude left, and the voice actress for Bayonetta wanted more money than they were going to give her, which apparently is a constant problem in the voice acting community. I had no idea it was that bad, but I guess it makes sense. They want to give most of the money to people who work on the game directly, I guess, but hey, the voice actors are kind of important. But that's why we have a different voice for Bayonetta / Cereza. I only noticed it sometimes because she did that good of a job, so whatever she got paid, I think she deserved, because she did pretty well. I'm sticking with it. My original rating from 1 out of 100, a 30 or 40, because I didn't like the game much. If I have to go from a 1 out of 10, unfortunately, that's between 3 and 4. I'm not changing my stance. What I didn't dislike, I outright hated. What I liked is so small a number that I can't even point it out easily. I do know that if the game ended on a better note, that would have saved it. If she walked away from that last fight triumphant as usual. And let's talk about that fight and how angry this makes me. Bayonetta 1. She kills an effing goddess. Probably technically a fake one, considering it was made by human hands, well, Lumen Sage, technically god hands, but still, it was an effing deity. And she destroys this thing, no worse for wear. A deity, of all things. A goddess. Game 2, same thing. An effing god. No worse for wear, other than losing the power of the left eye. Which she didn't even really use that much, frankly. It's like, she kills 2 deities. Game 1 and 2. Now don't get me wrong, I can understand why this guy would be tough to beat, because he can control and alter reality at will, and he can enter different worlds. But he's not a god. He is some bioweapon man-made thing that turned against his creators when he gained sentiency and decided he wants to be all that exists. A man-made bioweapon with sentiency. From another world. Yes, again, he can alter reality and mess with crap. But he isn't a god. So why of all things is this thing is what does her in? Why is he the thing that kills her? I hate this. If anything is going to kill Bayonetta / Cereza, it should have been an effing deity. Not some effing bioweapon. I know that's putting it too simply, but that's all he really is. A bioweapon that can mess with reality and worlds and dimensions and crap. And yes, that's really bad. But killing 2 gods? Come on! When I thought about it later, that really made me more angry. And it still makes me mad now when I think about it, because she killed 2 gods, and then this thing is what does her in. I know technically it was Gamora who killed her, but that wouldn't have happened if she hadn't been so worn out and wounded. Because I've kind of explained how it works from what I've looked into. You have to maintain high spiritual power and good mental control to handle the summon. She lost that because of how worn out she was and wounded. Which frankly, in that state, if I were her, I wouldn't have summoned Gamora. I would have tried someone else. Especially like Mad Emma Butterfly, because I don't think that's just purely a contract relationship. I think they're sort of friends. At the very least, she wouldn't have to worry about Mad Emma Butterfly stabbing her in the back. Or in this case, clawing her to pieces. Yanking her soul straight out of her body. But yeah, that bothers me. And I know that's just a gameplay mechanic for the players, but if you're going to kill the character, don't put healing items in the game. I know, it's a game mechanic. Even Maria pointed that one out, and I knew it myself already, but if you can heal a character in the game, or make them invincible, or power them up, or effing anything, and then they die, that's frustrating. Now again, it's an effing game mechanic. It's not actually something that she can do freely. But it still makes me a little angry. Ultimately, really, it just comes down to the game's ending. If she had walked away from that exhausted and wounded, I would have been willing to accept it, and she could have recovered, but it would take time. I'd be willing to accept that. But Bayonetta / Cereza dies, and Luca embraces her. They finally establish a relationship. That was only a long time coming. And they get dragged into Inferno together. I can understand why he went with her, because come on, the guy's always been into this woman. Just took them a while to do something about it. Not the worst possible way. They both die. I know Jean died too, and that did anger me, but we saw it coming with the amount of times we saw her alternate version die first, so it didn't really hit me. But Bayonetta, she's the main character, and with everything else she's been through, how can you kill her? I couldn't handle that. Then we have the ending, real ending part, which that one reviewer raged at. Like, he legit rage quit the game right when that happened. When Rodan calls Viola Bayonetta. I'm putting this out there now. If they do make a game 4, which they're already talking about, and who knows when that's going to come out, since this one took 8 years. Though there was a lot of reasons behind that. If they make a game 4 and you're playing as Viola, I am not touching it. I will not touch this thing with a 1,000-foot pole. She is not Bayonetta, and quite frankly, she doesn't deserve that name. I have to agree with that one reviewer again on that account. She does not deserve that name. She is too goofy, she's too silly, she's not really that cool. And she's just a witch in effing training. Bayonetta technically had finished her training. In game 1, she just had amnesia and couldn't remember how to do anything. That's different from being in training. It even says to be continued in New Generation. Seriously, if she's the main character in 4, I am not touching that trash. Even if they change her witch time, I'm not touching it. Maybe I'll change my mind later down the line, I don't know, but right now, I am not even slightly interested. I will look up the game on YouTube before I ever even think of buying it. I did not like that. I took it better than that one guy did, let me tell you. Oh my gosh. Something I vaguely noticed was that there's graphical problems. People have also lagged while playing this. I didn't notice that happen, but I did see that sometimes the game didn't look good. I only noticed it a few times. The first I can think off the top of my head was the waterfalls in Egypt. They looked a little funny at the very bottom of the waterfall. And it's apparently because the Switch's hardware just can't handle what they tried to do with this game. Don't know why they decided to do that if this hardware couldn't handle it. But hey, there's been a lot of weird game decisions over the many years, hasn't there? Anyway, all in all, I think I went over everything about the game I didn't like, which was most of it. I did like fighting sometimes. Pushing the buttons was still amusing, especially when you could send something flying occasionally. But for the most part, I just didn't like the game. The ending sealed the deal of me not liking it. I won't say I hated it, because I don't hate the game entirely, I just strongly dislike it in a lot of points. I waited these couple of days to try to calm down and think about it a little more and look at reviews to see if it was really just me being stupid, but no, there's people who agree with me on a lot of parts of this. Heck, even Maria, who's never played the game before, I showed her pictures of the characters and pointed out what I didn't like, and she had to agree with me. It's like, Luca was the only one I 100% didn't mind his design. Bayonetta, I only had the two peeves with her. Well, three. Her hair, the stupid bow, and her weird makeup. But all the characters had weird makeup. Though Viola was the worst. Seemed like something you'd do at a rave or something. I've never found that to look appealing. I'm kind of tired now. I did turn the game on so I could show some things off, but I kind of just talked about everything I didn't like. Frankly, I think the only thing I can safely say that I liked was some of the combat. I did like that the world was kind of big, and it was originally supposed to be open world, but that didn't end up working out. I did think the game was pretty for the most part. That's something else I didn't like, how it just dropped you into things and said, okay, here you go, have fun. First time they did that was with that first Bayonetta alternate we saw. And I did not handle it well. Like, the game just drops you into the situation and tells you to go for it. I'm not good with that type of thing. I don't know if anyone else is. If they are, cool, but that's not something I'm good at. I need time to adjust. Which leads to another thing I didn't like, how many enemies were always introduced. I don't have a problem with variety, it's just it seemed like it happened way too often. It felt like almost every chapter you were getting some new enemy. I don't think it was really that often, but it felt like too often. And I was still trying to get used to the other guys, so it was challenging and even frustrating. And I played the game on normal, unlike people who play it on hard. Oh, man. I didn't think her personality was off for the most part, though. A lot of people had beefs with her personality being weird. Bayonetta's, I mean, obviously. I didn't really notice excessive differences. But then again, I'm not the best at noticing that type of difference. I noticed other things, and when it was pointed out, I did notice it after the reviewers pointed it out. But I don't think I mind particularly because the situation is serious and there's a lot of stuff that Bayonetta / Cereza is thinking about. And yes, I have heard about the Bayonetta origins, Cereza and the Lost Demon. I'm kind of interested in seeing what that's like, but I don't know. This has been a bitter, bitter meal to swallow. I mean, guys, right now, I kind of want to pure platinum that first chapter of the game in 3. I'll keep trying it till I get it eventually, but then I'm not sure if I'm going to keep playing it. And at this point, I don't even want to play 1 and 2 because I'm going to have that bitter taste in my mouth knowing that despite how victorious she was in the first 2, she effing dies in 3. My brain just keeps replaying that moment. I can't, dude. You get so attached to this character. You love her even because of how awesome and cool she is. And then you watch her get effing destroyed. She won about the steep price of her own life. I just can't support killing your main character. I can't. If it was just to bring Viola in, there were so many different ways you could have done that. You could have just made it so Jean and Cereza have to be off doing something else. Frankly, for the new character, Viola only got a few chapters. So I don't know what that whole thing was. Man, a lot of people didn't like her at all either. If it wasn't her combat style, it was her personality or character model. It's like, don't kill your character. If you want to end the game series, then you shouldn't have made a 3. You should have just left well enough alone. 1 ended pretty well. Heck, it had a great ending. You could have just left that hanging. 2, however, wrapped up some stuff from 1 that you didn't fully understand, or you could understand better what happened with the witch hunts and such. So 2 was like trying to wrap up the story. And 3, the one reviewer I watched who took the ending really bad, he went with, this ain't the main girl, this ain't Bayonetta, this is some alternate universe Bayonetta who effing sucks. And then he's just gonna pretend 3 doesn't exist. Personally, I agree with this notion because I think he's right. This wasn't proper Bayonetta. It had cool aspects, it was sometimes fun to play, but it wasn't really her. Bayonetta's like Dante. She doesn't lose. So when you make them lose permanently, that's not good. Hey, that didn't even happen to effing Dante. I don't know what they're gonna do with Game 4, if they even make it. I don't know. Right now, I couldn't really effing give a flying F. I don't know if I'll play it. If I do, I'll either have softened toward the idea, if it's what I think it's gonna be. If it's not what I think it's gonna be, and we have Bayonetta back, I don't know if I can forgive Game 3. Because if you're just gonna bring her back, then don't kill her in the first place! Let's end this little video off on something fun, shall we? Just having fun pushing buttons. This is chapter 1. We'll let the cutscene roll. I did like this opening bit. Can someone explain
Before
to me
it's too late.
Why the game characters didn't figure out Sigurd was effing sus as crap? He was weird, and it wasn't just the coloring of him, despite the fact he looked a lot like the homunculi. we're just ignoring that. It's like, he was sus from the get-go.
Ah, shit!
But no one noticed it. Yeah, when you get a close-up of her face, like right there, pause the video and let me know if you agree with the makeup looking a little weird.
Not a cloud in the sky. Perfect day for a ball game. You know what that means, right? It means you found a way to drag me all over the city and turn my opening day ticket into toilet paper! Don't act like you don't hear me talking, huh? Huh?
You think showing her that's gonna get
you?
You
know how much shit I had to go through for this thing? Oh! Ah! Oh, shit! Jesus! How about a heads up for... Ah!
You have my deepest sympathies. But don't forget, it was you who agreed to do anything I asked in exchange for that
I
job.
I really hate
just
that
just because I said anything
now,
doesn't mean...
Let's be off.
Now where do you want to go? I've been driving around this city since
the crack of dawn.
Lollipop
does not look like a rose. Not like a red one, anyway. It's what it's supposed to be.
And now this damn thing's throwing a temper tantrum. The hell you doing? I just got this baby yesterday, and...
Less hot air, more gas.
I didn't really have any opinions on him selling pizza, by the way.
Everybody's getting screwed today. Me playing chauffeur, cause you gotta meet someone. So where are they? First the park, then the grocery store, and now you're saying you wanna try the pier. Hey, you even know where this mystery guest of yours is? What the... Holy shit! The hell you do that for?
Please, someone help me, before it's too late.
Hey, what is it? Don't tell me you got the date wrong.
No, it's today.
I do wonder about that.
It's here.
What?
It's just because she's sensing something
right
in the reality
here.
Getting distorted.
Right here. Don't move one inch.
Jeez. All right. Hey, how long do you expect me to sit here for, huh? And what am I supposed to do?
Surprised she could just walk on there still. Hmm. And no one comments that she just snags this thing. They just start staring as she walks past because she looks dang fine. Although with the little red ribbons in her hair, the blue kind of looks off.
It's the same shit with her every time, but she still gets me by the short and curlies.
It's because you're too easy to mess with, Enzo.
Huh? Rain? Where'd all these clouds come from? The hell is that? Not again! Life from on high just means more holy bullshit!
I wish that'd been the case.
What the... Ah!
Yeah. That is so grim.
A girl? Who the... Where the hell did she come from? You know, this kid looks kind of familiar. Whoa! Hey!
Please, take me to her.
Do I look like a damn taxi driver? You mean... her who?
Bayo.
Whoa. Oh, yeah, this? Oh, this? This is just what I needed.
Yeah, that red does not look good with the blue. At least I don't think so. How did no one see that immediately?
Idea. She just fell out of the damn sky. I got nothing to do with this kid. I swear. I just. Huh? Okay. Oh. Now what? Great. Don't tell me one of her pets got loose again. Come on. See, this is why I can't have nice things.
You can't have nice things because you buy cheap cars, dude.
Animals.
Pop a car
wouldn't
just lose a. Mirror like that so easily.
For God's sakes. Fucking leave her now! Come on, baby! Just get back over the bridge! Rodan?
Get lost, Enzo. Can't have you dying before I get my dough.
Made your car work. You look too hardcore to be dressed like that, man. Although it is amusing in a way.
Newer town, huh? And here's a friendly hello.
Who knows, maybe if we had Rodan with us, Bayonetta wouldn't have died in the end. There's more to kind of be there as just shopkeeper. Although, he was very minor in this. I don't know why they had to change that.
I do hope you haven't forgotten my order.
It's in the truck. Ready to go.
If anything, leveling up the infernal demons to get new abilities would have been cooler, but... I don't know. Rodan's shop became sort of useless. I do like that little OST right there. Cool. I do like the color scheme of these things, but I don't like them entirely. They're too different from what we're usually dealing with. I really don't like it. It's like trying something new is well and good, but don't take it too far, I guess is what I could say. But again, I'm not a proper reviewer. These are just what I'm thinking and agreeing with other reviewers I was listening to and watching. My own opinions. Sounds cutesy and I hate it. She didn't lose any style though, there's that at least. Although whenever, one reviewer pointed out that whenever she's in a different world and is watching her other part die, she kind of stands there and lets it happen. She doesn't even try and help. Fight. She just watches. There's that stupid giant bow. Yeah, this Demon Masquerade thing, I'm not afraid of. However, there is something I did like about how they set up the chapters. Is that there's particular verses and moments where you want to try to get a good score. You don't have to play the whole level to try to get a good score. You can just jump into the spot you want to improve the score. Although you do still have to play the whole level. I haven't messed with it yet. I fully understand. I can still say I prefer to just use her guns to fight. You can break the combo so easy right there because there's no enemies to hit. These guys already don't stagger too well, so I don't like to taunt. Eh, I got it. Well, there goes the pure plaque. Yeah, I don't care about your cutscene now. Buttons are still fun to push, don't get me wrong. It's still mostly fun to play. I hate Jean's chapters though. I will not willingly play those again. If I ever do this series on my YouTube channel, I'll have to seriously debate whether or not I play 3. And in this case, it would be because just how much I don't like the game, and probably can't make myself watch that last cutscene. Seriously. If I fully replay this, I won't play Jean's chapters. And there's no way I can play the last chapter. I will not be able to handle watching that again. F off, dude. Oh, look, this weird miasma crap. Step off that. Oh yeah, apparently those short witch time moments, it's measured on how well you do your dodge. If you don't do a great dodge, you get a very short witch time period. Which frankly, I have to agree with one viewer, if it's gonna be that short, don't give it to me at all. Just make me fail to dodge, because that short amount of time just gets you baited into getting slapped by something. The bewitchment in this chapter, that last one I'm missing. You're supposed to have Gamora do his gripping bite. Whenever I try to do that, that thing there just staggers a little. Oh yeah, as you can see, you got a pure platinum on that first part.
Just
the other parts only managed platinum. But I will show you what I mean. Because I do like this aspect. It makes it a little easier to get through the game if you're trying to get good scores. Okay, you see that? You can pick which part you start on. That's nice. And as you can see, that's the only bewitchment I haven't gotten on this chapter because I can't figure out how to make it work. That's the last chapter. Gosh, I hate Jean's chapters. Dang it, I keep hitting the wrong button. I'm not used to this crap. Wow, we did get a platinum reward on a Jean chapter. Huh. I'm impressed. It's probably entirely by accident, because I just rushed through her chapters. because I hated them so much. But yeah, my score on this really isn't that good. Like I said, I'll probably try to pure platinum chapter 1 just to say I did it. Because I don't have online, so I can't do the rankings. They don't usually care about that sort of thing as it is. I can easily say, though, it would be hard for me to fully play through this again. There was so much about it I just didn't like. And it's more in the gameplay mechanic part that would make it hard to replay than just the story. Because the storyline only hurts me at the ending. So yeah, I guess that's about it. I really didn't like this game. I'll probably still play it occasionally. But 1 and 2... as far as I'm concerned, 3 doesn't exist and compared to them. Just like with Plague Tale's sequel, I decided it doesn't exist. I also decided Dead Space 3's DLC didn't exist. Just, I don't like a bad or sad ending to something. I don't play a game for that type of thing. I don't watch a TV show for that type of thing, and I definitely don't watch a movie for that type of thing. This stuff is for a pleasant, good escape from reality, where you can just enjoy yourself and have a good story. Not where you get a character you've come to love, you see them die. Just no. Well, that'll be it. I will try to work on some Spyro because I know I haven't really done anything for that for a bit, and I know I haven't uploaded any streams because I was marathoning Bayonetta. Well, that's done. So I can start streaming other things. Again, I don't know what I'm going to start first because I still don't really feel like doing much. Yes, the ending upset me that badly. It was like watching a good friend have something bad happen to them, and I just can't take it. Well, I hope you enjoyed my rant once more. See you later, Twilights.